Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Appreciate your presence here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. And you that's listening out in the radio listen audience, most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping during the hour coming up, it can be an inspiration to you. And we appreciate you tuning in the radio listen audience. We appreciate your presence here in the auditorium. May the Lord bless you. If you have your Bibles today, I want you to turn, would you please, to the book of Genesis, chapter 49. Now, we made mention of the beautiful calendars, but I failed to give you my mailing address. If you want to write in for the calendar, my mailing address is Post Office Box 501, Athens, Georgia. The zip code number is 30603. You'd also like to have one of our brochures on our proposed Holy Land tour for March of next year. Now's a good time to get your name on the list. If you're interested and want to look over a brochure, just request it. Be glad to send it to you. I want you to turn to the first book in the Bible, will you please? I want you to be here tonight at 6 o'clock for the service. First book in the Bible, page 49. Page 68, chapter 49. I'm sorry, page 68, chapter 49 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. I do have, I believe, five Scofield Reference Bibles if you're thinking about one for Christmas. And I do have the five on hand at the present time. Now, Genesis chapter 49. I want to read a couple of verses. If you recall, last Sunday morning I spoke about the typology in the names of the sons of Jacob. And today I'm going to take those names and the expressions given by their mothers and apply that to the journey of the Israelites from Egypt on to the promised land. And I want you to follow me in the scriptures, waiting for you to turn now to Genesis chapter 49. I was reading the other day, last week I believe, about a man driving down the highway at night, and the trooper stopped him and pulled him aside and told him that you don't have any taillights on your automobile. And the man got out and he was kind of shaken up, and the trooper saw he was greatly shaken up, and he said to him, said, "This is not a real serious charge. You shouldn't be so shaken up about it." He said, "It's not the taillights I'm worried about. I'm wondering where my trailing wife is at the present time." Now, Genesis chapter 49, verses 1 and 2. "And Jacob called unto his sons and said, Gather yourselves together, that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days. Gather yourselves together and hear, ye sons of Jacob, and hearken unto Israel your father." Now, in the verses to follow, you'll have the list of the names of the sons of Jacob. And we have brought a message a time or two on those names pertaining to what Jacob told them about what's going to happen in the future to them in respect to them and, of course, their names and their descendants. But we'll not be dealing with that today. We're only dealing with the names of the children of Israel as they left the land of Egypt and went into the promised land, and the utterance given by their mothers at the time they were born. And so I want you to follow me in the scriptures and let's apply it to that journey. Now, the Bible tells us we are strangers and pilgrims on the earth. This world is not our home. We're just a passing through. And we know as we sojourn for God, we need to realize that. We are not real settlers down here. We just stay here for a period of time. And then we depart this life and go to a better world. That's a hope of the dear people of God. I was reading the other day about some of the scientists, the archaeologists over in some part of Africa, discovered some fossils over there. I believe they said in the paper and on the news around 60 million years old, something like that. And they're very jubilant about it. The reason is they think they've found the linkage between a monkey and a man. And you want to prove that a man came from a monkey. And they found these old bones, more than 60 million years old, they said. As the smart fellows, you know, they'll tell you 60 million years old. And they are very jubilant about it. They said, now we have at last, think we found the linkage. We can prove that a man came from monkey. And I read that. I wondered how stupid can a people be in the name of education, ever learning, and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. People have to be stupid to believe that kind of stuff. Evolution in that respect, that man descended from a monkey. If man descended from a monkey, why aren't they doing the same thing today? Well, that alone would prove their ignorance of their theory. And we know where man came from. We know how he got started. And what they're trying to do is prove that God's a liar, that the book of Genesis is not true. And the Bible said, let God be true and every man a liar. So they're the liars. They don't know what they're talking about. And they're downright ignorant and downright stupid, if you're asking me, to try to prove from bones they found more than 60 million years old that man came from a monkey. Well, now some of you people, some that's listening to me today, you might want to believe that your ancestors swung by their tails and hung in the jungles years ago, but mine didn't. I had some ancestors that might have swung by their necks back yonder many years ago, but they didn't hang on a limb by their tails. And so I don't believe that rotten theory. It's not true. And we need to realize that man came exactly like God said he came. God created him. And all you have to do if you want to find out where man came from, go read the Bible. Read the book of Genesis. Tells you exactly. And it's a shame you have people ever learning and never able to come to the real knowledge of the truth. And the truth is found in the Word of God. Now today, as we move along, talking about the sons of Jacob as they were born, there were 12 of them. And then these mothers, they uttered some words and phrases to the extent that it had a meaning that we cannot. Made this statement. His mother said, surely the Lord hath looked upon my affliction. Genesis chapter 29 and verse 32. And Leah conceived and bare a son, and she called his name Reuben. For she said, surely the Lord hath looked upon my affliction. Now you can apply that to the affliction and the persecution and the torments that the people of Israel went through while in the land of Egypt. Now Pharaoh made it rough on them because he did not want them to increase in number. He made it rough on them. He worked them very hard during the days that they dwelt in the land of Egypt after the death of Joseph. And he afflicted them, the Bible tells us. In Exodus chapter 2 and verse 25, and God looked upon the children of Israel and had respect unto them. Now they were under great affliction in that land. Now you know how they came about being there. They sold Joseph down there in the first place, and he was carried down into the land of Egypt and later became prime minister of that great land. And then he sent back and brought his brothers and his father down and their children, and they dwelled in the land of Egypt some 400 years. But after Joseph died, then the Pharaoh began to oppress the people of God, the Israelites. And especially just before they departed, they oppressed them greatly because they were multiplying in number and they were afraid that some enemy might come in to try to overrun Egypt, and then the Israelis would join up with them and overthrow the government. And so they did not want them to multiply. They oppressed them greatly. So from the name Reuben and the expression of his mother Leah, said, surely the Lord hath looked upon mine affliction. Apply that to the affliction of the Israelites while in Egypt. Now you must keep in mind that Pharaoh is a type of the devil. The land of Egypt is a type of the world. There you find the people of God, the Israelites, God's chosen people. The Red Sea is a type of redemption. And through the wilderness is a type of the journey on the land of Canaan. And you keep that in mind. The second son I want to mention is Simeon. And Leah, his mother, also said, because the Lord hath heard that I was hated. Genesis chapter 29 and verse 33. As she conceived again and bare a son and said, because the Lord hath heard that I was hated, he has therefore given me this son also. And she called his name Simeon. You can also apply that to the Israelites in the land of Egypt, because they were hated by Pharaoh and the leaders in that land, and probably all the Egyptians. They despised and hated the Israelites. They discovered that God was with them in many ways, and God blessed them, and they despised them. In Exodus chapter 3 and verse 7, and the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know of their sorrows. So it said here, the Lord knew of their sorrows and knew they were hated. These first two names you find here, an expression describing the first stages of the children of Israel being hated and afflicted by the Egyptians. So in applying the first two sons, the first two names, we find here Reuben and Simeon, apply that to the suffering and the hatred and the despising of God's people while in the land of Egypt. I would like to say here, we tape the Sunday morning program, and of course it's always available if you're interested in the message out in the radio listen audience I'm bringing. It'll be on tape number 95. And I want to tell you that while it was on my mind, and lest I forget about it, you can tape, all of my Sunday morning tapes are available. And then we come to the next one, name number 3, and that's Levi. And Leah, his mother, said, this time will my husband be joined to me. Now there was a distance between Leah and Jacob. She was his wife, of course, but he loved Rachel. And Rachel also was his wife. And so she said, when this son came, she said, my husband now will be joined to me. He will love me more than he loves Rachel, I'm sure, because she bare him these sons. Now the Bible says in Genesis chapter 29 and verse 34, as she conceived again and bare a son, and said, now this time will my husband be joined unto me. She said, I know now, since I gave birth to these sons, that my husband will be joined unto me and love me even more than he loved Rachel. And so that here applies to the Israelites in the land of Egypt when God was joined to Israel and became the husband of Israel through the Passover. I'll give you the scripture in just a moment. We find here in the Bible that during the Passover, God was brought very close and near to the Israelites. And so in Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 and 32, behold, the day comes, saith the Lord, I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day I took them out of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. Now here we find that God became the husband of the Israelites through the means of the Passover there in the land of Egypt. Jehovah was joined to Israel through the lamb that was offered. You know, God said to the fathers of the Israelites, I want you to take a little lamb and slay the lamb, put the blood in a basin, take some hyssop, dip it in the blood, and strike that blood on the doorpost and upper lintel. And the placing of that blood on each side of the doorpost and on the lintel above formed a cross. And that pointed forward when Jesus would die on the cross with blood coming from his hands and his head. There's a hang on the cross where the thorns penetrated into his flesh. So here we find God Jehovah was married or joined and became the husband of the Israelites at this particular time. And so we too are joined to Jesus Christ by a lamb. John the Baptist, standing on the bank of Jordan, saw a man coming toward him, and he singled him out and pointed, no doubt, and said, behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. You find that in John chapter 1 and verse 29. And so that's the way we are joined to Jesus Christ, the bridegroom, and we're the bride. It's through the blood of the Lamb. That's the only way. And so we find here then that God Jehovah was joined to the Israelites through the sacrifice of the innocent lamb and the blood applied in the Passover there that night in the land of Egypt. So you keep that in mind. That's another step as we see the Israelites getting ready to move out of the land of Egypt. With that in mind, that moves us to son number 4. Son number four was named Judah. And Leah, his mother, said, now will I praise the Lord. You'll find that in Genesis chapter 29, verse 35. When she gave birth to Judah, she said, now will I praise the Lord. We must apply that to the time when the Israelites gained the victory over the Egyptians at the Red Sea. At the Red Sea, they came out victorious. They crossed over the Red Sea by God congealing the waters. They passed over on dry ground. And then when they crossed over and landed on the other side, they looked back and God let the water come upon the army of the Egyptians and drowned every one of them, including Pharaoh. There they drowned them. God drowned them and they saw their bodies washed out upon the seashore. And they began to praise God. In Exodus chapter 15, verse 11, it says, who is like unto thee, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like these, glorious in holiness, fearful in praising, doing wonders? So they said that. They began to praise God. Then Miriam became the cheerleader, and she began to lead them in praising the Lord as they moved on away from the Red Sea, thanking God that God had drowned the Egyptians and they were safe, completely safe across the Red Sea and could not be reached by the Egyptians. And they had much to praise God for because they came out victorious and had won the battle. In Psalms 106 and verses 11 and 12, and the waters covered their enemies, there was not one of them left. Then believed they his word, they sang his praises. They really rejoiced and shouted and praised God when they saw what the Lord did for them at the Red Sea, how God allowed them to cross over on dry ground. And as soon as they were crossed over, God broke up the water, and the water came forth and drowned the entire Egyptian army. And so they had much to praise God for. They had gained the battle, the victory, and they praised God for that. Now they came out victorious through the battle. I read in the paper the other day about this man executed down here in Florida. And then an old bishop made this statement about it. He said that this man conquered death. He said the man executed conquered death. Well, he didn't come back from the dead. Must be something wrong somewhere. The only man that's ever conquered death was the Lord Jesus Christ. And he conquered death and came out of the grave. And this old apostate bishop said this man conquered death. Not a word of that true. That's a lie of the devil. He did not conquer death. He died and paid in death for the terrible crime he had committed. That's exactly what should have been done to him. It's a shame they kept him out 10 years before they did what they should have done in a matter of a few days after they found him guilty. Well, maybe someday we'll learn some sense in America and get some teeth in our law and straighten out this judicial system we have today is rotten, it stinks to high heaven, and then we can curb the crime situation in America and less of our dear friends and law-abiding citizens to be killed by these cold-blooded murderers. You're welcome. And so we must move on now and to find another name mentioned here, and this name is Dan. Number five, Dan. And Rachel said, God has judged me. Now after the Israelites crossed the Red Sea and praised God and shouted the victory, then Dan, Rachel said, God has judged me whenever he was born. Now this brings us to the time when God judged Israel for murmuring. Now after they crossed the Red Sea, they went into the wilderness. And later on, they stopped the shouting and praising God and rejoicing and began to murmur and complain and grumble and gripe about where they were going and what they were doing and the ways of their leaders, Moses and Aaron, and Moses in particular. They didn't like what Moses did. They began to murmur against their leader, their commander, their pastors it were, and God judged them for it. God didn't like it. God didn't like their murmuring. God didn't like their grumbling. We find that Miriam murmured against Moses because of an Egyptian woman, and there God struck her with leprosy. And Moses had to pray for her that God might heal her, in which he did. God was showing his disapproval of murmuring against his leader. It's a serious thing to murmur against God and murmur against God's leaders or God's pastors that are God called and God anointed. You might not agree with them and everything they do, but it's not pleasing to God to murmur about it and grumble and growl about it. Ought to always pray for those you disagree with in that respect, if they're God's men and God's servants, because there's none of them perfect, and they need your prayers and concern and consideration. And so they murmur. As after crossing the Red Sea, they begin to murmur later on, and God dealt with them in judgment. God sent fiery serpents among them, and you know the story. Many of them died. They were bitten by these serpents, and they died. But God sent a remedy after Moses interceded for them. And so Rachel said, God has judged me. Then we come to number 6, Naphtaliah. Naphtaliah is the next one. And Rachel said, with great wrestling have I wrestled with my sister, and I have prevailed. In Genesis chapter 13, verse 8, and Rachel said, with great wrestling have I wrestled with my sister, I have prevailed. And she called his name Naphtaliah. Now this carries us to the time when the Israelites had to wrestle against Amalek and his crowd. We find the first real testing came when Amalek came out to attack Israel. And they engaged each other in battle. They began to fight. And they had to really pray and wrestle. And Moses stood at the top of the hill and upheld his hands. And as long as he upheld his arms, held them straight up, then Israel prevailed. But when he became so tired until he had to drop his hands, then Amalek prevailed. When he raised his hands, Israel prevailed. When they went down, Amalek prevailed. And we find that Aaron and Hur came and said, we'll do something about this. One got on one side of Moses, one on the other, and they held up his hands until Israel completely whipped Amalek. Now, beloved, we find here a wrestling going on between Israel and Amalek. And you're wrestling today. You have a battle taking place within you. And that battle is going on between the inner man and the outer man. Now, if you're a born-again believer, you have a dual nature. Now, let nobody tell you that the Adamic nature has been eradicated. That is not true. You still have the Adamic, although you have a new nature been added. And that was added the moment you were saved. The moment you were born again, that came in you a divine nature, the nature of God imputed unto you. And that is the inward man and the outward man that you have to contend with every day. They fight against each other. They struggle one against another. And if you obey the outward man, then you walk afar off from God and you get into trouble. If you obey the inward man, you walk with the Lord and in the Spirit and please God and do the things that God would have you to do. Paul said in Romans chapter 7, he said, now when I want to do good, I find evil is present. And he said, many times I do things I don't want to do. And then he said, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? And then you go to Romans chapter 8 and you find the deliverance. So you'll have that battle. That battle will be there as long as you live. That's why Paul said, I die daily. That's why Paul said to crucify the old man. The battle is there. Walk in the Spirit and you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. Now we come to number 7, and we have two here mentioned. And their names are Gad and Asher. When Gad and Asher were born, Leah said, a troop cometh. A troop cometh. Genesis chapter 30 and verse 11. Now this takes us to after the crossing of the Jordan River and to enter into the promised land. And when they do, the Canaanites come forward to fight with them. And they said, a troop cometh, and they engaged in battle in the land of Canaan to clean out the Canaanites. In regard to Asher, she said, happy am I, signifying the battle had been won. Genesis 30 and verse 13. So we know Joshua took over from Moses' leadership. After God bared Moses, they crossed over the Jordan River, went into Jericho, conquered Jericho, moved on up into the land of Canaan there, conquering city after city. And so the troops came, the battle was on. And that's typical of the Spirit-filled life. Now, you haven't seen anything yet until you feel with God's Spirit in the way of a battle. Just as certain as you completely surrender to God and God Almighty takes over your life completely, here comes the battle. The devil wades in to see what he can do about it. As long as you're backslidden on God, As long as you're doing nothing for God, as long as you sit at home and complain and grumble, and because maybe you don't feel good and don't try to serve God, the devil's not going to bother you. You're doing exactly what he wants you to do. Doing nothing for God, you're complaining and grumbling. I'd be afraid to do a thing like that. I'd be afraid I would really get sick and disabled to get out of the bed. Beloved, listen to me. Whenever you completely surrender to God Almighty and say, Lord, here I am, take me over, use me completely, then that's when the Spirit of God takes over. That's when you're controlled by the Spirit of God, which means you're filled with God's Spirit. Then here comes the battle. The great battles take place in the land of Canaan. Canaan is a type of the Spirit-filled life, and there you have the battles taking place. And one battle after another they fought. Read the story of the Israelites conquering the land of Canaan. One battle after another, they had to take the cities and take the towns. And there they came out victorious. And Ashi implies, happy am I, signifying the battle has been won. And Joshua led them to victory. The battle was won and established their tribes in the promised land. Then we come to number 8, and we have two names mentioned here. And the names Issachar and Zebulun. Leah said, God has given me my high. Genesis chapter 30, verse 18. In regard to Zebulun, God has given me dowry. So this tells of Israel being occupied in the land. After they had conquered the land, there their tribes were placed in the land where God wanted them. Joshua assigned them their territory in the land. You know, it's quite significant that the name Asher means your foot dipped in oil. In my travels to the Holy Land, we travel through a territory that's completely filled with olive trees. And out of those olives, they secure their oil for food, for their lamps, and various other things in those days. And Jacob said in the book of Genesis there, in this chapter I read, my text, he said, Asher shall dip his foot in oil, and signifying that Asher will be planted in a land where there'll be a lot of oil. And so they planted the tribe of Asher there among these olive trees. There's many, many olive trees on his land where his tribe settled. And how wonderful it is, how significant, how blessed is the word of God to see how that was so fulfilled. And so it said here, the battle is over, we're being planted, and God has given the victory. It tells us here these names imply that by the expressions of their mothers. And then we come to the last two, and that's Joseph and Benjamin. Rachel said, the Lord shall add to me another son. In Genesis chapter 30 and verse 24, she called his name Joseph and said, the Lord shall add to me another son. That other son came, and his name was Benjamin. Now, you know the story if you read it. You know how that Rachel was the woman that Jacob loved with all of his heart. He was tricked by his father-in-law, Laban, and was given Leah, the oldest daughter, first. And then he had to wait another week and before he could get the one he loved, and then she was given to him, and then he worked 7 other years for her. He'd already worked 7 years, he worked 7 other years, and then later worked 6 more years, making 20. But anyway, he loved Rachel, but God did not give him any children by Rachel. Rachel became somewhat frustrated. She prayed, she cried, and she even went to Jacob, said, now we want some children. Jacob said, don't blame me, blame God. Not my fault. And she kept praying and looking to God, and she said, God, give me children, I die. And God heard her, and God answered that prayer. And she gave birth to a beautiful boy. His name was Joseph. She named him Joseph. One of the greatest characters in the Bible. Very beautiful boy, no doubt looked like his mother. She was a beautiful woman. And so she gave birth to Joseph, which means God has given me a son. That Joseph there is a type of Christ's first coming. Then she said, he shall give me another son. When she gave birth to Joseph, she said, God's going to give me another son. And sure enough, she conceived again the second time and gave birth to a son, and she named him Benjamin. Benjamin means the God of my right hand. Benjamin points forward to the time when Jesus will come back and rule with a rod of iron. Joseph is a type of the first coming of Jesus. Benjamin is a type of the second coming of Jesus. So God gave her Joseph and Benjamin. But believe it or not, whenever she gave birth to Benjamin, she was still a young lady. And they were moving out of from Jerusalem, Salem at that time, moving down toward the little town of Bethlehem. And she gave birth to Benjamin and she died. She died giving childbirth. It's the first place in the Bible where you find a woman dying giving childbirth. And they buried her beside the road. And now they have a huge monument there at that grave. I see it every time I go to the Holy Land. I stopped by there a few times, we did, and looked at it. But right beside the road, on the way from Jerusalem down to Bethlehem, you'll see Rachel's tomb. And the Israeli women that expecting children, you know what they do? They come there in droves when they expect children and kneel down and pray there at Rachel's tomb, praying that the Lord won't let them die like Rachel did when she gave birth to Benjamin. And they come there and pray to that end. But anyway, she gave birth to Benjamin, and they buried her beside the road there on the way from Jerusalem down to the beautiful little town of Bethlehem. And the grave is still there. The monument is there. The building is there. They built the shrine, rather, built over the grave. And we've seen it many, many times. When Leah died, she was buried with Jacob in the burying ground. Abraham, his grandfather, his grandmother were buried, his grandfather, and also his mother and dad. Jacob and Leah was buried down there at Hebron, at Machpelah, a place there, some land where Abraham had bought for a burying ground. But Rachel was left alone beside of the road. And there the women, the Hebrew women, make a journey to that tomb when they're expecting a child, many of them, and pray that God not let them die during childbirth. I've given you these 12 names and the expression of their mothers and the meaning thereof. I hope it'll be something that you'll think about, you'll cogitate upon, and it will be a help to you as you sojourn. I want to give you this story. There was a mother one time out in the yard hanging out clothes, and a neighbor screamed and said, "Lady, your house is on fire." And she had a little baby in that house in a little crib. And she ran into that house and brought that little baby to safely. Brought it safely out, rather. And there, brought it to safety. And there she bringing the child out, of course, her hands were severely burnt and also her face. And it left big scars on her hands and on her face. The little daughter grew up, became a beautiful, lovely young girl. And she graduated from high school. And they were to go on a trip as a graduation present, if you want to call it that. But anyway, they were to go on a trip down the Hudson River. And their parents were invited to go along with them. So the mother and dad went along with their lovely and beautiful daughter. They were on that big boat sailing down the river, and this mother came by, and some of the young people laughed and sniggered and said, "Look at that horrible looking thing. That's a hideous looking woman there. Look how horrible she looks." Said, "Who is that woman?" And her own daughter sitting beside these, her friends, said, "I don't know. I don't know who she is." And her mother heard it. When they arrived back home, mother said, "Daughter, I want to talk to you." And she said, "All right." They went in the room alone. And mother said, "Honey, I never did tell you, but these scars on my hands, on my face, I received them saving your life. Our house caught on fire, and the neighbors screamed and told me I ran in and got you out of the cradle and brought you to safety. In doing so, I want you to know for the first time, these hands were burned and so was my face." That girl grabbed her mother. She kissed that scarred face, those scarred hands. She said, "Mother, I'm so sorry. I didn't know those scars were put there to save my life." That's what Jesus did on Calvary. They marred him. He didn't look like a human being. He was beaten and whipped on Calvary's cross. And they whipped him and beat him and he died in your place and mine. If you don't know him as your Savior, you ought to get acquainted with him today. Let's stand to our feet. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that you'll take the message and use it to thy glory. May thy name be honored. May Jesus be glorified. I brought the message you laid on my heart. Now, Father, that's as far as I can go, and I pray that you'll use it now to glorify thyself. In Jesus' name, amen. Debbie's going to play for us on the instrument as she does. If you're in this building, not right with God, backslidden, want to get saved, want to join the church, if for any reason that you feel like you ought to come forward about this morning, I want you to come. We'd gladly help you. Would you come while we wait? come right on. You can join the church, get saved, come back to God. Or for any reason you feel you ought to come, would you come? Are you looking for a church home? Would you like to get saved? Would you like to come back to the Lord? Any other reason God is speaking to your heart? Would you like to come about it? While we wait, we're giving you time to respond.